Listen.
On January 15th, 1995. Nobody could be trusted.
Well, it seemed like they had it all in their favor. And all of a sudden, Danny Wolf, on this timing, no hard feelings here. However, wait a minute!
What is that? You guys are teammates. You don't do that!
It was the Sunday Showdown.
No way!
Still outside off!
Cal International Wrestling's... greatest ass kicking.
Rick from the Ultimate Fighting Champion.
Hardest fought.
Keep your eye on Al Snow. Doing something good.
Wrestling spectacular ever.
Homicidal, genocidal, death-defying. He is a man with more heart.
International Wrestling's Sunday Showdown.
Wrestling fans, DeKalb International Wrestling. I'm Broadway Danny Wolf, joined by my broadcast buddy, the voice of CCW, Ron Head. Cal International Wrestling. I think the word international says it all about today's card, Ron.
It sure does, Danny Wolf. Today, we have our tremendous, stellar lineup here at the Sunday Showdown. You will see here today, Danny Wolf, along with all these people here in West Hollywood, California, in our main event, Ultraman, being accompanied by J.R. Benson. He will take on what has been known as the most homicidal, genocidal, suicidal, death-defying athlete on the planet. That man is Sabu, who ironically will be brought to the ring by J.R. Benson's arch rival, Johnny Legend. Some interesting circumstances, and what a match we'll have there today at Sunday Showdown.
Well, with wrestling managers, there's always a rivalry between rival wrestling managers, and there's a dislike, a hatred, if you would, between this Johnny Legend from right here in Southern California and Northern California's J.R. Benson.
Well, these two have such a hatred for one another that they spare no expense in buying the contracts of two of the toughest, meanest wrestlers who will also put out a great show, giving all the fans their money's worth. The main event, as well as many others, Dan Severin of Ultimate Fight Championship fame will be here today in a special strong style match. He will be here at Sunday Showdown.
Well, wrestling fans, Ron, we hope you enjoy the show. Cal International Wrestling is ready to go.
Introductions are underway here. We're starting out even before a bell even sounding. RUR 2000. Robotic-like, and there is the bell officially starting. RUR 2000 already claiming some sort of low blow to start. A pleasure to once again be working alongside you, Danny Wolf.
It's great to be here, Ron Head. We're in West Hollywood, California. Cal International Wrestling, great opening bout. RUR 2000, the man from Japan, or from Russia, and Makoto Morioka from Japan.
I believe this is the first time we're seeing RUR 2000 here in West Hollywood. The Sunday Showdown, we will see a tremendous evening here tonight as these two grapplers starting out, locking out a bit of the feeling out process here, Danny.
We got to be careful for Makoto. This is also his pro debut. He's a trained kickboxer, Ron, and he's trained, in fact, with Benny and the Jet, so better watch out for this guy. Wrestling skills and kickboxing, and RUR, I don't know if he knows kickboxing from Russia, but I don't know, fans having a good time already here in West Hollywood, Ron Head. Cal International Wrestling underway.
Morioka now starting out with already a painful maneuver onto the left arm of RUR 2000. Morioka also a black belt in judo and kendo.
So we say Cal International Wrestling, Ron, first match already, a wrestler from Japan and Russia. You don't get more international than that, do you?
It doesn't get any more international, and that's what Cal International is all about. RUR 2000 already rolling into a lateral press type combination. However, no count by the referee here.
Speaking of pro debuts, I think this is even referee Nick Benich's. What was that? Nick Benich's pro debut. And I think RUR is getting Makoto a little upset in there.
Well, RUR 2000. Not too many people know a whole lot about him. He seems to be a bit robotic in the ring. Some people even claim he is somewhat of a robotic mind. However, highly disputable, Danny.
Well, it's funny to see missing with the drop kick, Makoto, but it's funny to see RUR talking to referee Nick Benich. I wonder if Nick Benich understands Russian. I don't know if this guy speaks Russian. He may speak Spanish, for all I know.
Well, we only assign the finest referees here, and he already keeping the two apart. RUR 2000, though, putting his hands on, whispering something into the air. What language do you think he could be understanding there right now, Danny?
Well, being that RUR 2000's from Russia, I would hope he's speaking Russian, but that may not do him any good. I don't know if Nick Benich, the referee, knows Russian.
Tremendous bridge by Morioka. However, RUR 2000 tying him up.
I don't know, referee Nick Benich trying to get position for a count, but right now RUR, one of his right leg draped over the ropes, and Benich trying to break him up. I don't know, having a tough time right now.
Well, fans calling for a clean break.
I guess in any language that could be tough, can it?
Sure. Imagine so. Back now in the corner, hard knee. These two really not holding back in this opening match, Sunday Showdown. What a tremendous night ahead, and already these two have a lot to prove in front of everybody.
Vicious slaps, and you can hear the flesh against the chest. Oh, this RUR not really keeping by the rules. A lot of rakes to the eye, slaps, chops, not breaking. Maybe he doesn't understand English or understand the rules of wrestling. This is his pro debut, at least here in Cal International Wrestling.
Well, I would hope he was at least versed in the rules of Cal International Wrestling. Maintaining a rear chin lock, a form of a sleeper hold. However, Morioka reversing it down into an arm bar.
And the fans getting into that. They like Makoto Morioka style, and the fans appreciate it so far.
Hard Irish whip snap, suplex.
Beautiful suplex. And
starting out with the Fujiwara arm bar.
Submission
hold.
That's it.
That's it. And his pro wrestling debut.
Your winner of the match in 3 minutes and 53 seconds, Makoto Morioka.
Shut up! 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 Shut
On Gemini Kid and Greg Regalado. J.W. Fargo. Well, things already getting out of hand here, Ron. Just right after the introductions, all four men going at it. Nick Bennett's already with his hands full, but I have a feeling this match may remain like this. Oh! Southern Comfort starting out with a tremendous double teaming on both Gemini Kid and Greg Regalado.
The Dixie Demon has wrestled in Cal International before. He's brought in his friend from Tennessee, J.W. Fargo. So we better watch out to see what kind of chemistry they have right now. It looks pretty
starting
good.
Starting out again. It looks like all this time. Ooh. Both Southern Comfort getting nailed each by dropkick. Now Gemini. And Regalado.
Ron, who's Mistress Stacy? I don't know. She's got a whip, some kind of, a horse whip that she keeps banging on the ring. She better be careful. Though, because I know some of these wrestlers here in Cal International won't tolerate that maiden hit her with.
Mistress Stacy.
Is that her name?
Stacy Domina, I'm called, making an abrupt debut here at Cal International, escorting. Oh!
And Gemini Kid came flying off the ring apron and just took it right to, the Dixie Demon is now going into the ring stairs. Regalado throwing him in the ring stairs, and right now Gemini Kid rolling J.W. Fargo back into the ring, and referee Nick Bennett trying to get a little order in here. And has this match even begun?
I heard the bell officially start. The crowd noise so high here that you can barely hear anything happening. Dixie Demon and Greg Regalado, of course, having one combative match at Aftershock 94. And J.R. Benson, a bit upset, a bit cranky, because Dixie Demon was put away by Greg Regalado. And the Gemini starting out with the Gemini stomp, getting the fans behind Mistress Stacy. J.R. Benson unhappy. J.R. Benson has some intense ties with the Smoky Mountain Wrestling Federation.
And this is where I said, I heard him. Oh, no! Regalado.
Well, they don't exactly play by the rules in Morristown, Tennessee, and that's exactly why J.R. Benson brought them back here to Hollywood, California. Dixie Demon, a bit of a personal vengeance against Greg Regalado. But he better not forget that this is a tag team encounter. It's not just one-on-one, and he better not let personal pride get in his way. Reversal now, Dixie Demon, hard clothesline.
This could even be like a double tag team, a two-on-four, because I have the feeling between J.R. Benson and his Mistress Stacy that this is a complete unfair advantage, but maybe Greg Regalado and the Gemini Kid can rise up to the occasion and go against the odds, if you will, of a two-on-four. But right now,
trying a cross body. Demon catching him in midair.
Gemini Kid up on the
look out behind you. And a cross body. Cover him, Nick Bennett. Now this time, Gemini Kid going for the count.
Yeah, he went for the Nick Bennett, who's a little out of position. Maybe not expecting Gemini Kid to actually leap into the ring, but it's all right. Greg Regalado now is going to tag the Gemini Kid. And maybe they'll work on the arm here of the Dixie Demon. Gemini Kid doing a little dance in the ring. Look at this, twisting the arm.
And the fans.
Not a popular man with the fans here in West Hollywood, California, Ron.
Well, he blasted out here with the vengeance that seems against everyone but Gemini.
Beautiful move.
And it looks like the Dixie Demon not moving.
So the
Gemini Kid for that over 220 pounds, very agile. And you just saw that in that last move, and he's taking complete control.
Well, he's very stocky, has a low center of gravity, using it to his advantage with a double underhook suplex.
Beautiful suplex, but right there is J.W. Fargo coming into the ring. Referee Nick Bennett getting him back outside. And there's J.R. Benson and Mr. Stacy. I mean, Mr. Stacy trying to hit referee Nick. Would hit him with that prod or whatever she's got in her hands, but
well, looks like they're trying
about them.
Looks like they're trying to distract referee Nick Bennett, who I believe Danny is using just a bit of extra leniency here at Sunday Showdown.
So far, I agree with you, but back to the match here. Dixie Demon throwing Gemini Kid in his corner, and J.W. Fargo's got a
trying to get the dandruff up.
Very deceiving. You see this? J.W. Fargo working on the head of the Gemini Kid in the corner. Referee Nick Bennett's not really knowing which direction he's going to. And I don't know.
A bit chaotic here, but
yeah, very chaotic right now, Ron.
J.W. Fargo. Southern Comfort. Showing everything but comfort for their opponents right now. Greg Alado now being whipped into the ropes. Dropkick into the chest area.
Beautiful dropkick by J.W. Fargo, a bit of a mystery man from Tennessee, but I gotta tell you, if the Dixie Demon brings in someone from his home state, the J.R. Benson, you gotta believe they'll be tough.
And of course,
probably a wise choice, and so far, they seem to be working well as a team.
Irish whipping him in, now a double clothesline, flattening him.
The Gemini Kid, I'm not going for the cover. Tags off his partner, Greg Regalado. Of La Puente, California.
Well, after what happened at Aftershock 94, those of you who have not yet witnessed it on video cassette, it was true destruction.
That is a must-see video for anyone who has not a bad match on that card. And so far, this match is fitting right in. And the Tennessee duo, I see Dixie Demon yelling out to the crowd. Maybe he should be worried more about his team right now. He's not faring too well.
J.W. getting a big snap suplex now, but taking the cheap way out. Is that how they learn things in Morristown, Tennessee, Danny?
Morristown, Nashville, Memphis, I guess all over Tennessee, but they raise them big down there and tough. And Tennessee is a hotbed of wrestling. J.R. Benson seems to recruit pretty well from the Smoky Mountain region in Tennessee and all over the South.
Well, the very wiry J.R. Benson doesn't like to associate himself with losers.
And only time will tell how his team fares here, but right now, Nick Bennett's kind of letting things go. A bit lenient with the referees. And Gemini Kid is,
tremendous kick. Right into the jaw of Regalado.
Right now, J.W. Fargo is dishing it to the mush of Gemini Kid, who's down
that
on
cover.
The
here we go, one, two.
No, Regalado with the save. Kicks J.W. Fargo on the back of the head. And right now,
one, two.
Fargo kicks out. Nice roll up there by the Gemini Kid, but only a two count.
An Oklahoma roll now. A pinning combination, one. Gets a one count only. Gemini Kid now trying to clear the cobwebs, shaking his head. And J.W. back into his team partner.
Puts Gemini Kid's face right into the soul of the Dixie Demon's wrestling group. And right now, Gemini Kid rolls out onto the hardwood floor. There's no team on this floor. You roll out, you can get severely injured if you hit this. This is like a basketball court here. There's absolutely no give in a basketball court.
None whatsoever. If flesh and hardwood floor have a confrontation, I think you know who might win on that one. Brawling outside the ring now.
And going out into the crowd. These fans better be careful. You know what happens in Cal International Wrestling matches. You better be on your toes because this action spills out all over the arena. And right now, all four wrestlers outside the ring. Looks like J.W. Fargo's got a hold of Gemini Kid. Oh! Spun Gemini Kid into Regalado, who I think might have kicked his own man.
I believe he accidentally struck his own partner there.
And right now, referee Nick Bennett's counting the wrestlers.
They're still going at it, though. That was, however, definitely unintentional.
Gemini Kid climbing up to the top turnbuckle. J.W. Fargo on his feet in the middle of the ring.
Into
shoulder
the
block, and I don't know, will he go for the cover, Ron?
He's a bit staggered and dazed.
And right now, there's Dixie Demon. Come on.
You gotta wonder a little bit about Dixie Demon. A bit mysterious, but with such an attitude.
I don't think he's all there, and nothing against the state of Tennessee, but I think he's a few bricks short of the load. But right now, dumping Regalado out onto the floor. So Fargo now going to work on that Gemini Kid. I don't know. DDT.
Big DDT. Regalado trying to get the chair.
Oh,
two, three. Was that it? Was that an official count? Let's see if we can wait for Nick Bennett's decision. They're still going at it. Well, referee is letting this match continue. I'm not exactly sure. Maybe our timekeeper was a bit hasty in ringing the bell as they're still going at it. Referee letting this match continue. No, I bet that was that looked like a hasty bell there by the timekeeper as that hand barely slapped through. A pile driver on Gemini Kid. JW Fargo delivering. Regalado, however, breaking that. Does not get a count. This match is definitely continuing. Close to the action. We're not talking about near falls. We're talking about falls. Well, false falls. Hard shot into Dixie Demon. Regalado, an Irish whip, and a big thunderous splash into the corner on Dixie Demon. Well, for a minute we thought that was it as he rolls him up. One, two.
Only a two count.
Dixie getting his shoulders up.
Now Dixie Demon on his knees in the middle of the ring. Mistress Stacy pounding. Oh!
No, he misses that kick.
Now Dixie Demon with the kick to the gut.
Oh. And a DDT again on Regalado this time.
And Gemini Kid now comes in and he DDTs Dixie Demon. And here comes JW Fargo into the ring. Don't tell me another DDT.
It's not going to be.
Oh! No. What was that? Three or four straight DDTs. Wrestlers struggling to get on their feet. Another DDT
another one.
By Regalado on Fargo.
Danny Wolf, who's the legal man in the ring right now? Who are the two?
All four of them. I can't tell you. I don't think even referee Nick Bennett can tell you or any of the fans. Some order has been lost in this match a long time ago.
Fans here, a bit confused.
Oh, I'm a bit confused too, Ron. I don't know. I think referee Nick Bennett, maybe he's doing a good job by just letting him go at it.
That's it, giving the fans a true winner there.
And these wrestlers having a hard staggering around the ring. Punches with not a lot of effect. Right now, Gemini Kid throwing the...
Clotheslining. Dixie Demon over the top. You got to think with the exhaustion factor, Danny Wolf.
Gemini Kid's going to throw, looks like Fargo. Whips him. Fargo returns.
Oh, no!
His own man! Gemini Kid colliding with his own man, Greg Regalado. Fargo throwing Regalado.
Wait a minute, covering him.
I don't think so. Stop.
No, this is a two,
no.
Three. Oh, that is it, fam. That is it. Well, I tell you, with all the distractions of not only Benson, but Mistress Stacy. Helping Mistress Stacy down another V. A little bit of miscommunication and mistiming in the ring. Let's give him credit though for a valiant effort. Gemini Kid, Greg Regalado. Well, it seemed like they had it all in their favor. And all of a sudden, Danny Wolf, a mistiming. No hard feelings here, however. Wait a minute!
What is that? These guys are teammates. You don't do that. And it's not Regalado's fault, but I can't believe. Look at the Gemini Kid, he's laughing. What is funny about doing that? Even your own teammate.
Charles Manson has his fans. I tell you, this is not what we needed to see.
Oh, no, not a pile driver. Let's get some wrestlers out here.
Oh! No. Fans, it looked like Regalado may have landed on the back of his neck there. this here. This wasn't Regalado's fault.
I don't understand this. Promoter Dan Farron down at ringside, give me some sort of warning. Maybe the Gemini Kid to get out of the ring.
He wants a microphone, Danny Wolf.
I don't believe this. I mean, I come all the way down here.
He was on a job.
I beat the living daylights out of people.
You were doing that for you down, man.
Hey, don't blame me because your mother gave you up for adoption. Now, Greco, it was obvious that you were holding me back. And you are my new past. So now, when you look upon tonight as the Black Sunday that it is, and when you wonder why you feel like a Pittsburgh Steeler and a Dallas Cowboy, you will remember the reason they call me the Gemini Kid is because I'm twice as good as any other man.
What happened here just earlier on, you losing in the tag team match, but it was not
when Greg Regalado messes up. You have to understand it. It isn't just this match. It isn't just Regalado. It's everything. Now you recall La Fuente. I'm with that schmuck, Benson Lee. Nothing goes right. Every time I team with somebody else, nothing goes right. And I figured something out. The problem is that somebody has not understood that life changes. You need to remember the Gemini Kid, two sides. Pasta, Alex, heaven, hell, paradise, and pain. So you must understand that the time has come to make a change. For after all, life is but a walking shadow. A poor player that sets and struts upon the stage. A tale that has a curious, periodic ring, and in the end signifies nothing. And Regalado, you now signify nothing. The next time you cross my path, Greggy, I won't be so kind. I won't be so nice. I'll just finish you.
Words from the Gemini Kid. Words that at times may sound poetic. Was just surely nauseating. Let's move on here on Sunday Showdown.
Fans, if only Smell-O-Vision were active in your homes right now. I'm not sure if I feel more peace, harmony, or I'm just getting deeper into thought. Johnny Legend escorting Vandal Drummond out, who is burning incense.
Sis, it's noisy in here, and I just want to get a little meditation time in.
Away from starting your match. You want to meditate?
I want it so quiet in here, I can hear an incense stick drop.
that the cheese fell off his cracker a long time ago.
First off, where are the strobe lights we ordered? Huh? We'd like a little moment of silence here while we have our mantra, okay?
There's no smoking in the strobe lights.
You know, there's going to be plenty of smoking in the next nuclear holocaust, so let's all just calm down here. Folks out there going to assume a lotus position with us.
What in the world are we witnessing here?
Feel free to join in.
That was all about, but my sinuses are much clearer, as well as my head.
Our participants, let me introduce first the manager, Johnny Legend.
What an oddball this legend is.
He wants to be called Johnny the Lotus Legend.
In that lotus position, he's actually meditating.
Let's bring out the rest of the lotus.
Well, and though drumming not on his own with Johnny Legend, they have a partner, and I wonder what their partner has to make of all this. Cato Lee coming to the ring with Johnny Legend. We'll tell you a little bit more about these two as the match progresses, and here are the opponents. A bit of levitation and a bit of down to business. Productions. Lisa Cato Lee placing herself in the front row. Where is Johnny Legend going? Asking for the house mic.
Well, if you really want to run to the 60s, we're going to have a happy physics party in just a minute when we part well this idiot's brains. This Buffalo headed, balling idiot JR. Next time we get a chance, let's see what a room looks like. Does have a safety pin in her tongue. Have a look at the lovely Lisa Cato Lee. Okay,
Cato Lee, while receiving not so warm from an introduction are being well received by these fans. I tell you now, I'm starting to get a little buzz going from that incense. Jasmine. Yes, Jasmine. And there's the bell.
Can't believe I made it back here, Ron. That was one of the strangest ring introductions I think ever.
Wait a minute, Danny. Hold still, hold still. You had a little lipstick on your cheek there.
Oh, come on. Every time this Vandal Drummond...
Of hair. Physico nuclear. Vandal Drummond does not want physico nuclear, at least now.
Right now, here comes Stephen DeLeon. You know, he's got a punk rock band. Get ready for this, Foreign Objects. And the shirt says, Go Die.
Go Die.
And he's a lead singer, or I don't know, maybe a guitarist, who knows, for a punk band called Foreign Objects. That sounds ridiculous to me, Ron. But right now, some sort of, what is that, a pentagram on his shirt? Some sort of pentagram or
All I know is my bowels don't feel too secure right now after the incense, the music, the chanting. And what's with this Lisa Kato Lee here?
Yeah, let's look at it. I mean, quite an attractive woman, but what is she doing with Johnny Legend? I mean, attractive women and Johnny Legend, I don't believe mixed, but never know.
Lisa Kato Lee, I've been told.
Is she a starlet? Some sort of movie star? I don't know.
Well, she does have her combat training in the martial arts. Johnny Legend, always quick to pick up the snappy women who earlier on working the chair, very unusual strategies here. That's Stephane de Leon. Go Die.
Yeah, I don't get what a Go Die in a pentagram. And right now, the Cal International Wrestling Middleweight Champion, Physico Nuclear, is
getting his right arm in that wrist lock.
Yep, taking some punishment, but
reversing.
Making the comeback, and very nice whip. And right now, Stephane de Leon bangs his. Bangs the face, or mask, if you will, protecting his face. I have no idea what this guy looks like. Can that be his real hair, this Stephane de Leon? Is it sort of
certainly
mask,
hope not.
And he's going to tag in this, I don't know what we're going to, Vandal Drummond, but the different sort of Vandal Drummond. Wants everything his own way. Wants it quiet, wants this, wants that. Johnny Legend, no right
you better
up there. Get him on the ground. Johnny Legend has no right interfering, probably has no right being at ringside. I may have to go to promoter Dan Farron and matchmaker Larry Doyle about keeping this guy away. We don't need his interference and his shenanigans at ringside. But right now, look at Vandal Drummond.
Taking it up, now spitting into the crowd. You have to be careful with that.
Right now,
Johnny Legend on the chair, cheering his man on. Hard whip in. Vandal, however, retaliating with a big shoulder tackle. Quickly crossing over, keeping the momentum going, and body drop.
Tremendous back body drop, and Vandal Drummond right now. Look at Johnny Legend, not too happy out there, marching around the ring. But he said the hair. Come on, Legend.
Oh, try to tilt the world. Physical Nuclear reversed it into a flying head scissors.
You know, it's so funny, Ron. Anytime his team is not doing well, Legend blames hair pulling, illegal tactics, foreign objects, the referee's missing something. I mean, he should be turning it the other way. It's usually him with the foreign objects and all the illegal activity.
Exactly. And you're talking about foreign object. I mean, we have a man in there who's a walking foreign object. I'm talking about his band. With absolutely no regard for their audience. I've heard them almost annihilate clubs where they play.
I don't think I'd want to go see him. Maybe risking your life going to a foreign object concert. But right now, Vandal Drummond, Physico Nuclear in the ring.
Vandal not climbing all the way.
Oh,
and get a drop kick.
I don't believe that. Vandal Drummond went down about 12 feet to the hardwood floor. The shame is this interesting wrestler, Terry Iwakura, pro debut from Japan, and he's not getting much action in the match so far, Ron.
Very conspicuous, waiting on the apron there.
Pretty calm. I don't know. He really, you got three, not actually counting Kato, Lee, and Legend, and Drummond, and Nuclear, and this Stephane de Leon. I don't know. This Iwakura looks a little out of place.
Stephane de Leon. Very unorthodox wrestling attire.
What is this Vandal Drummond? He's crawling around on the floor by the ring steps. He's moving a chair.
And now in comes Iwakura.
Terry Iwakura getting in. Let's see what this guy's got. They're going blow for blow, kick
mixing it up. Well, Devon with the big knee.
Low blow, and then drops a knee to the throat, and he's just pounding away. Come on, referee. John Hanson.
Oh, wait a minute.
Look at Vando Drummond going at it.
Do I smell Coke Cola now?
Whatever you got, Johnny Legend here, things never go as planned. It's always chaos, massive chaos. Look at Vando Drummond. I don't believe high-fiving fans in front row. Here in West Hollywood, California.
Referee having a hard time maintaining order here as I heard Vandal smack that hard wood with his eyes probably stinging from that jolt cola that was thrown in there.
Right now, Stephen Neely. Oh, no! A fan. I believe he broke his glasses.
With a big anchor.
Vandal Drummond threw a physical nuclear right into a fan in the front row, and I guess he's sitting in the front row. You might be, that's not funny. Vandal Drummond tossing nuclear, the middleweight champion of Cal International, head first into the stairs, and he's on the ground, and now in the ring. Here comes Ewa Curl with some martial arts.
And there are the two. Wait a minute. German suplex. Yes.
Oh.
Stefan De Leon is hurt. Cover one, two. Two count only. That German suplex is physical nuclear. Getting posted there by Vandal Drummond.
We're about 8 minutes into this match, and I don't know how much of it's gone taking place in the ring. A lot of it seems to take place outside amongst the fans, but I don't envy John Hanna. He's got his hands full with these four wrestlers, and stuff happening all over the place. I don't know, in the back of the room, take a look at Johnny Legend standing up on a chair out there. Catch that, Ron? Look at this.
Johnny Legend, what does he keep getting on chairs for? Watch out!
Stephen De Leon with the chair. Oh! And again, I don't know, he's trying to hit physical nuclear. Yes!
Right on the cranium. I'm not sure he got to block that or not.
Wrestlers are everywhere right now.
They're not holding back. And, well, yes, we're talking about referees giving leniency. Nothing peeps fans off more than coming to a match and seeing it end with a countout. Seeing it end with a disqualification. Referee trying to use as much leniency as possible. And we have two separate battles happening right now.
Absolutely, Ron. We got, Stephen De Leon. Submission move on Ewa Curl. I don't know, he's under the ropes.
Yeah, Boston Crab, he just needs to reach over.
No, he's saying no. I don't know, it's hard to say if he can reach. I believe he can, but...
That looks like he's right there. Johnny Legend taunting him.
Now, right now, Vandal Drummond and Physico Nuclear coming back into the ring. All four wrestlers in the ring now. And referee John Hanna trying to get some semblance here, and it's not easy.
A whelps on the back of Vandal Drummond coming out here. Lisa Cato Lee leaving ringside.
Starlet or movie star? I don't know. Is she coming? I don't know. I don't know if we can trust anyone from Johnny Legend coming over here to the
broadcast booth here. High backdrop, Lisa Cato Lee. I have to question right now, what is your role in this match? How did you get involved with Johnny Legend?
I'm a student of anarchy.
A student of anarchy? Look out!
Oh, no!
How's that for anarchy right there? I just received a PhD in anarchy.
Oh, tremendous DDT. This is the future of wrestling.
This is the future of wrestling. This is anarchy in action. Don't you get it?
On the hard cement.
Now, Vandal will pick his heart. You see, he's meditating even as we speak. He's gathering his life force.
Wrestling fans, it's all 10 minutes to go.
He saves himself for the end of the match.
Well,
he's gathering mental energy from the crowd. And he's going to be able to shoot that. You see, that's called chi. Those are students of Kung Fu.
It's called chi?
It's called chi. It's life force. He's gathering it from the crowd. And you see, he's starting to expend it just now.
If you can see the look on my face, fans.
I can attest to that. I don't think Ron Head quite understands chi and Kato and Johnny. None of this
really
makes any sense.
Wait a minute. Submission hold, and that's it.
Rings the bell.
Well, was that chi for you? Lisa Cato Lee.
She is the secret to everything.
Right now.
That's it. Come on. Why isn't he breaking it, Lisa?
Well, I mean, after they started that stuff out of the ring, can you really expect these guys to be able to cool down so fast? Just a little residual to it.
I am not only confused, I'm a bit... of Anarchy squeaking out a victory. Lisa Kato
yes,
Lee.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Johnny Legend. Well, Johnny's not through yet.
What do I tell you in a second? We're going to get physical, physical. We're going to get physical. I don't know who this other hungry walk number one headed buffoon is, or that ponytail from Hell Referee. Just like I told you, we're here, I'm representing Southern California. This generator didn't have the guts to come out here. We're victorious, we didn't have to lift a finger, and we're gonna go back now and reflect on what just happened. That's not gonna long street for you.
Fans, go explain that one.
Drumming with scissors, Johnny Legend, Stefan Delio.
Wait 1 second! Wait 1 second! I know why I hear that name. That is not my name. My name is Anarchy. Get it straight. I am Anarchy and only Anarchy. I never ever want to hear that name come out of your mouth or anybody else's mouth again. Got it?
His hostility is showing that the inner child in him is too hurt, man. Isn't that right?
That's right.
You hurt. You hurt. Johnny Legend. Maharishi John Legend Yogi.
Maharinos, call me what you will.
Oh, God bless you. This man, Ron Head.
That's Ron Head. Grateful
Dead Head. Wait a minute. This is the California flag here. Are you proud to be a California? Of course I'm proud. Ron, normally that would irritate me because we had words last time we talked, but Johnny Legend has taught me that I should really learn to accept people around me, and there's a whole new me. The purpose of this flag, I want to tell you, is so we can give people a history lesson to show how I came to be where I am now.
We're reaching for a new plateau of awareness here.
Yeah,
These gentlemen are new age Neanderthals. You've got to understand that. They are the architects of anarchy.
So,
for Anarchy Incorporated, call it what you will.
This
is the next dimension.
Northern California is kind of messed up because there are a bunch of heathens up there. We know about psycho-cybernetics and higher levels of understanding. And this California is like, I want to tell you a little bit about it.
Yeah.
People would know about it in school if Ronald Reagan didn't screw everything up by cutting our education funds. And the old guy, now that he has Alzheimer's, probably can watch it.
We play by our own.
And
so let's start with the little bear.
I want to tell you how this bear got on the flag because California was stupid enough to put Reagan in office. Was hard enough, inbred enough to elect him president. So I want to tell you about this bear. This bear was put on the flag because of something called the Bear Flag Rebellion, where a bunch of white, pasty people came to California. And they used this bear as a symbol to kick out anybody who was not white as they were.
What that is the city, brother?
That's right. So,
187, straight to heaven, baby.
Wait,
that's
what
right.
About harmony and understanding?
That's what we're talking about.
This is what I'm talking about. What do you mean harmony and understanding?
California is a stupid state because you got a bunch of inbred rednecks who voted for 187 when it's the most piggish,
stupidest thing I've ever heard of in my entire life. Hey, I want all you people out there, all you light-skinned people, to go pick your own fruits and vegetables.
sister made love, they gave birth to a pharaoh or a queen. In America, in California, when a brother and sister make love, they become lizard circus geeks who reside in San Bernardino or Riverside.
I feel better. Come here, man.
Get me away here! Get me away!
Evolution! Help. This is evolution!
Help.
In action!
Get evolution! Away. Help me!
In action!
And Terry Funk, good, coming from the double cross, Grant is double tough, clearing out the last four rows of chairs, dropping the chairs hard.
To order copies of Cal International Wrestling's Aftershock 94, featuring Sabu versus Al Snow, with the tremendous brawl ensuing with Terry Funk, along with the backstage interviews, along with Dan Severin versus Road Warrior Hawk, along with the hair versus mask match where Vandal Drummond lost all 20 pounds of his hair. Send $16 payable to Dan Farron at 8707/D, Lindley Avenue, number 212, Northridge, California, 91325. Cal International Wrestling's Aftershock 94.
For this match, John Hanna, veteran referee, no stranger to Cal International Wrestling. And I tell you, fans, we need the best right here, because no strangers to one another as well. Capitan Oro and Superboy. This is for the very prestigious Echo Plaza Lucha Libre Trophy, and there's the bell.
Should be a great match here. Oh, missing with a dropkick right off the bat is Superboy. And I'll tell you, better watch out. Capitan Oro, the first Echo Plaza first ever champion. So,
and he might be quick to retain the belt. The quick, short Boston Crab, single half crab submission hold.
Well, he's put to the test immediately by Cal International Wrestling. Superboy's wrestled all over the world, so a gritty veteran. He can snag that trophy right away from Capitan Oro in his first defense. You better watch out.
Danny Wolf, these are a bit unusual rules for these two, as these two are used to working two out of three fall matches, thus giving them a little bit of leniency, meaning you could lose a pinfall, submit, and still come back to win the match. However, this match, only one fall. You think that could throw a little bit of sticks into the spokes of their strategy, Danny?
Absolutely. These guys, I think, are usually wrestling two out of three fall bouts, so definitely a different strategy for each one of them. But interesting move, so far. Style, all part of Cal International Wrestling, and they bring it all to you, and we're here in West Hollywood, California.
Capitan Oro and Superboy, both with deceptive physiques, meaning they don't look like they could bring out the agility in one another, yet there you are, flying through the air with, oh, the greatest of these, monkey flip.
Fantastic monkey flip by Superboy. Now he's daring Capitan Oro. He says, come on, bring it on. John Hanna reffing this match for the Hadco Plaza Trophy. Oh, and Superboy,
I tell you, neither of these men are really too crazy about the fans here in West Hollywood. All they care about is one thing, winning the winner's share of the purse, and for this matchup, the Hadco Plaza Lucha Libre Trophy.
And it's a beautiful trophy and plaque. I mean, what is Superboy doing? Leaving, getting a count now by John Hanna. I don't know, is he leaving?
Well, you're not going to get a belt that way.
No, not even close. And referee John Hanna, I think, up to a four count, but Superboy now coming back, making his way to the ring. He's up to a six count. This would be highly unorthodox if you'd be counted out. You don't win a belt when you're, or a trophy when you're counted out, and that would be pretty stupid. But
well, I believe what he's trying to do right now is break any of the momentum that Capitan Oro had. What is he doing now?
I don't know what Superboy's doing. He's mingling with the fans. I think he should concentrate on the match. This is a title match, and here we go.
A bit of mental warfare now working as Capitan Oro getting the high backdrop, leapfrogging over, and clothesline down. Superboy feeling that, I believe, right on the jaw. Ooh. With the mask, it's very hard to tell. Those masks hide facial expressions. You got to think it's pain right now on Superboy.
Ooh, tremendous sticking. Look at that cartwheel and backflip by Superboy. Showing some acrobatic prowess. Superboy in the red and black. Capitan Oro, the champion, in the gold and black.
Look out, Capitan!
No.
Faking him out.
Almost got Superboy on it. Capitan Oro hiding behind a post against the wall. And I don't know. This has been a tremendous match so far. Superboy and Capitan Oro, Lucha Libre style, right here in Cal International Wrestling.
One fall, however, remember.
One fall with a 1 hour time limit.
And both of these men, with a lot of pride in their heritage, wanting to go back down to their roots and revive the glory of the Hatco Plaza. This time, Capitan getting in, and Superboy right away. Listen to those chops reverberate.
Set right out of the hardwood floor. Photographers are getting some pretty good looking. Jimmy Suzuki
would not there. Miss this for anything.
Now he knows when the big wrestling shows are, and he's always at them. Phyllis Lee taking pictures of ringside of the fans. Everyone quite interested in this Big Cal International Wrestling show. And right now, Hanna getting Oro into the ring.
The champion ducking what looks like a clothesline. A tilt-a-whirl backbreaker.
Is Superboy getting right onto one knee? It looked like he was going to get right up. You'll feel that.
Making him out in a standing dropkick. Capitan, all over the top.
Oh, and Superboy colliding with one of the fans in the front row. Watch out.
Capitan flipping all the way outside the ring.
And there go the chairs. Some of the fans having to move from their seats. Both wrestlers on the hardwood floor here.
Notice no padding here. Cal International Wrestling does not need padding.
Absolutely not, Ron. You got that right. Capitan Oro's in the ring, Superboy, just starting to make his way back into the ring. Captain Oro, I don't know, communicating with the fans in Spanish. Oh.
Setting up now, Superboy grabbing a handful of trunks, referee counting, and vertical suplex from the apron.
It's the hard way to get back into the ring to be suplexed in, but that's fair. Everything almost seems fair in Cal International Wrestling right now. Captain Oro, whoa! Leg drop right across the throat of Superboy.
And this looks like it could be at a cover. One, two, three. Not a three count. However, coming very close, Capitan Oro and Superboy.
5 minutes gone, 55 minutes to go.
I tell you, these athletes, deceptively agile and with also deceptive amount of stamina. As Superboy back body drops, Capitan Oro cartwheel, handspring, headbutt.
Superboy now, is he going to leave? Don't tell me.
It's his turn.
There's no padding on the floor.
Taking out a few rows of chairs here.
And the fans seem to appreciate it. Dan Barrett, promoter, going over, trying to keep the fans away. Doesn't want anyone injured, but I think right now Capitan Oro and Superboy, both a little injured, both lying on the floor, chairs scattered about, and referee John Anna is counting. He only got a 10 count to get in the ring, so his wrestlers better hustle.
They're up to a 6 count now. Referee John Anna counting. Superboy.
Superboy going up to the top rope. I don't know what he's going to try.
Dropkick off the top onto the champion.
I don't know. Superboy's, actually I see a little blood on the back. He might have cut himself from one of the chairs, but.
And a cross body sending both men over the top, and again the count begins.
And I like this Cal International fan. Got to admit, they know when to applaud, they know when they've seen a good move in the ring and outside the ring, and they appreciate the effort. These two luchadores are giving West Hollywood and Cal International Wrestling today.
I tell you, the fans really aren't picking so much of a favorite as they are applauding and cheering the wrestling, as neither of these two wrestlers have really been too courteous to the fans. Again, all they care about, that winner's share of the purse, that Hecto Plaza Wrestling Trophy, the championship, and the big W in their corner.
Referee John Hanna still counting. I don't know, these two wrestlers seem to spend just as much time outside the ring on the floor amongst the fans than they are in the ring, but Lucha Libre, that's the style, though. It's all over the place. It's a non-stop excitement, and right now, these two dishing out the ball.
Look out.
No way!
Still outside, oh! Moonfaulting from the middle turnbuckle outside the ring.
And that's a hard floor outside the ring, and I can't tell. Hannah's counting both the rest of Superboy getting into
Superboy
the ring.
Superboy getting back in. He's still maintaining the count, and that's it. Looks like we have a winner here. Remember, fans, Lucha Libre rules apply to this, especially for the Hecto Plaza Trophy.
Wrestling fans,
grassroots as well. The AWA old rule book applies, and yes, a championship can change hands on a countout.
Was it a countout?
Still very gracious with one another, and the new champion. That'll be the only belt, or rather championship, that could change hands on a countout. We
see in the ring now as we're starting.
An announcement before this match begins. Matchmaker Larry Doyle has suspended Thunder Machine, that's right, Thunder Machine, for improper conduct.
Well, there you are. There's more.
I call it the captain's closet. It's a little bit out of my control. So, until June 27th, I just can't wrestle. So I decided to bring out... I decided to bring out the only man who is comparable to myself, or even Gemini Kid. That is Rick Sanus.
Officially, we have professional misconduct. Reaction here for Rick Sadus. And the music now starting. And here he comes, down to ringside, making his rounds. The ever happy, smiling Thunder Machine suspended from wrestling at Cal International. However, apparently not suspended from being at ringside. We'll see if we can get verification that he will be allowed to stay at ringside.
Hey, wrestling fans from San Diego.
John Hanna searching Jason Redondo as well as the Sadus. Referee John Hanna, all business.
It's good to be back, Ron Head. Second half action here. Big match, a grudge match. I don't know, Thunder Machine was supposed to be in there, but matchmaker Larry Doyle would not let him wrestle because of something called improper conduct. I don't know if you can clear that up. That can mean a lot of things.
Well, officially, on our press release here, we have professional misconduct. Well, a lot of times we hear double talk, even within the bureaucracies of the Wrestling Federation. Professional misconduct can mean anything.
But the thing that's funny here is, look who Thunder Machine, he's walking around with that whip. He gets the Sadus to take his place, and the Sadus is familiar with Jason Redondo. These two know each other, so sort of a grudge match.
And apparently, as I mentioned earlier while you were doing your introduction, as these two already getting tripped up backwards there.
Oh!
Hard slap. Jason Redondo.
What an insult to be slapped in the face twice. Sadus, that time it's
not. Again.
There we go. Redondo now pounding away on the Sadus.
Good hip toss.
Good hip toss, and the Sadus kind of wobbly now. Drop kick by Redondo and Sadus
over the
top rope and right onto the hardwood floor. And John Hanna should be starting the count on the Sadus, though Redondo's going to go out.
Propelling himself, catapulting, using the top rope.
Right out onto the floor on top of the Sadus. The Sadus, who was already hurt. Now, I don't know if he's going to be able to get up. Jason Redondo might be a little nuts to try a move like that. I don't know.
Well, everyone needs to be crazy to come in here to Cal International Wrestling, where pretty much the clause in your contract is wrestle for us at your own risk. Jason Redondo, not at all a stranger with the ever-smiling Thunder Machine.
The Thunder Machine smiling. He's been made some mention about coming back in late June. So I don't know. It'll be interesting to see what unfolds there. And right now, the Sadus really not trying to get, kind of avoiding getting in the ring, making a few attempts and then backing back up.
Thunder Machine.
machine. I don't know, it's a 15 time limit match. 15 minutes, I don't know how much is going to be spent outside the ring. But now finally the sadists climbing inside, and let's get him going.
Well, we saw Tempers flare earlier. And I guess he felt that he was not gaining the proper momentum trying to break it. And now once again locking up with Redondo. Getting that wrist lock.
Right now, Redondo reversing the hold, putting the wrist lock now in the headlock. He has the sadist, and takes the sadist down. Referee John Hanna looking. One, two. Lose a match that way, Ron. I mean, that's pretty embarrassing.
Doesn't happen a lot, but it does happen. The fact is, in pro wrestling, you have to be aware at all times. If you're daydreaming for even a fraction of a second, that could be it. And your history, you're out of it.
You're absolutely right, Ron. And let's congratulate Eric Caden of Hollywood Book and Poster winning the grand prize here at Calumet. Great door prizes, raffles, tremendous souvenirs sold here, terrific wrestling merchandise. So if you ever can get into a Cal International Wrestling show, make it down here. A lot of great vintage wrestling souvenirs on sale today, and oh my!
Tremendous belly-to-back suplex. Jason Redondo needs to keep aware of his surroundings as the sadist now sizing him up and dropping a knee, a shin. And Redondo trying to stagger his way back to his feet.
And I'm keeping my eye, Ron, on this Thunder Machine who's walking outside. He's taking a seat in the front row. I don't know if you get that. I don't know he's out there. I know he's sort of representing the sadist. It's his replacement today.
I'm not sure that he actually has an official license to be in the corner of the sadist.
No, I would say he doesn't have a license like J.R. Benson has and his Johnny Legend character. Oh!
A quick roll up from behind. One, two.
Oh, almost snuck. Oh, I don't know. We almost had a surprise pinball. Look at the sadist dropping the forearms down and out.
I tell you, Jason,
to the head up.
Danny Wolf, Jason Redondo has had many great battles, and not too many people are aware of this now. But one tremendous veteran who works usually in the All Japan rings has taken Jason Redondo under his own wing. I'm talking about Doug Furness, partners with Dan Trofast. Training Jason Redondo, hopefully to bring him in to the Japanese ring. However, the training... a two count! What a feather in the cap of the sadist. At the 5 minute mark here, the sadist now with the rear chin lock on Jason Redondo. It turns out that Doug Furness resides in San Diego, California, same hometown as Jason Redondo.
Jason Redondo hailing from San Diego, California. Let's congratulate those San Diego Chargers on making it to their first Super Bowl today, where they'll be facing the San Francisco 49ers in the Super Bowl in Miami. But let's get back to this match. The sadist is going to dump.
Through the ropes.
Redondo through the ropes on the floor. You better watch his Thunder Machine.
Wait a minute, distracting the referee. Turn around, John Hanna.
No, Hanna, turn
Thunder
around.
Machine.
Thunder Machine with the chair. And counts for Redondo. I don't know, maybe on the head or the back. You can't see from our vantage point. But fans seem to be applauding it. I don't know. Maybe.
Well, these fans, I think, have a bit of a taste for violence.
It's Cal International Wrestling Show seem to bring that out in people. I don't know if that's good or not, Ron. We're sort of safe up here, but now everyone counting along with referee John Hanna.
This makes me very nervous. Fans like this, you gotta love them, but you gotta think. Bambi must have been glad he had Thumper to comfort him and not these fans.
Oh, without a doubt.
Tremendous monkey flip. Jason Redondo getting his second win now. Trying to keep the sadist who's trying to squirm away. Oh, missing a big splash, Danny Wolf.
Need to be here, Ron, head of... Oh, tremendous go down off the top rope. And the sadist maybe go for the pin now.
Does he have it within himself to go for the cover? Rolling him over, covers him. One, two, out of three.
That's about a 2 3/4 or 2 5/8 count. And Ron Head of CCW fame in Northern California and Broadway Danny Wolf here at Cal International Wrestling in West Hollywood, California. And right, the sadist. Redondo.
It's always a pleasure to be representing CCW. Now, as we're known, Extreme CCW. Keep your eyes and ears peeled. As we'll be working head-to-head with Cal International, bringing you, the fans, the finest, the greatest wrestling, as you see from the top. Big splash.
And that could be it. I don't know. The sadist now rolls off of Redondo. I think if he would have just stayed on him when he landed, he might have had the pinfall. But I think both sadists landing created a tremendous amount of pain into his midsection. Now he's trying to crawl over. And no, you got to turn Redondo over, which he's doing.
Has him covered. Counting one, two. Getting close.
Got another 2.5 count.
And the Thunder Machine is not smiling now.
No, Thunder Machine's telling referee Hannah that it was a 3.
Not smiling for a change, I might add. Irish whip reversal. Redondo now. Missing a roundhouse kick and both.
Double clothesline, and I don't know. Hannah's already up to 2 on the count. That could be it. I don't know. Both wrestlers hitting the mat pretty hard there. And Thunder Machine giving words of encouragement to his sadist, who's now first to his feet.
Now wait a minute, the sadist now trying a double axe handle, trying to size up a bit too slow as Redondo maybe a bit too quick again, firing into the midsection. Danny Wolf has been a complete teeter-totter, seesaw encounter as a reverse atomic drop.
Another clothesline by Redondo, Ron. Another clothesline by Redondo, but Sadist, oh, I thought he was going to make it to his feet, but a lot of punishment.
Those clotheslines, a lot of people really need to get an understanding as we get a 2 count right there.
And Hannah, perhaps if he was in position, might have been the 3 count to end the match. I don't know. It's a 15-minute time limit match, and we're probably about halfway done.
A whip now by Redondo.
Oh!
Sadist blocks and gives a tremendous kick. What is he doing now? A hard neck breaker.
Gives him the neck breaker, and I don't know, he's got to
cover him.
Arm draped over.
One, two, three.
Boy, I don't know, I've not seen that many 2.5 counts in a long time, Ron.
A lot of close calls here.
But you were right when you said it before, this match is a teeter-totter, and right now the sadist dishing up punishment, putting the head of Redondo into the turnbuckle. No giving those turnbuckles. I went over and touched one earlier, and those things are pretty hard. Now what is the Thunder Machine
doing? Wait a minute.
Doing? Get him down, referee. He has no right to be, actually has no right to even be in the building.
This man suspended, holding Redondo.
Oh!
There you are! Signaling for something, climbing all the way as Thunder Machine out of commission.
This could be it, Ron.
Climbing all the way to the top.
Oh!
Connects all his body weight on the Sadist. 1, 2, 3! A 3 count, fans.
The winner of your match in 9 minutes, 50 seconds, Jason Redondo!
Wrestling's ultimate fighter, Dan Severin, will compete today in a special strong style exhibition. Here are some of Dan's thoughts on almost winning the Ultimate Fighting Championship and Hoyce Gracie.
Well, I look forward to a rematch situation. I believe in order, you know, just a one time to win doesn't really constitute a true win. I always believe the best 2 out of 3 scenario. I know I'm doing the Olympic trials. They use the same system right there. So in case a little situation took place, I'm not trying to take anything away from points by any means, but I think just a fair thing to do would be to allow best 2 out of 3 case scenario. He's already one up on me. I'll give him that at this point in time. But I'd like to face him on just an equal basis, one-on-one, really not in a tournament situation, so that he's fresh, I'm fresh.
Just days prior to the Ultimate Fighting Championship 4, Dan Severin's fellow wrestler in UWFI, Yoji Anjo, was backed down from a challenge by Hoyce Gracie's brother, Hickson Gracie. This made national media in Japan, and here are some of Dan's thoughts on that incident.
Basically, what I've heard was that such an event did take place, what the outcome was of the event, but as for actual detail, no, I'm really not privileged. I've heard, you know, quite a few rumors on the event as to how long the match lasts, what different types of things took place during that match, but I really don't have, unless you were there, I think that's the only way of truly covering that event.
Recently, Dan Severin got a victory over Road Warrior Hawk at Aftershock 94 in La Puente, California. Here are some of Dan's thoughts on that matchup.
I'm going in the match with someone like Road Warrior Hawk, and I know it's going against a very mean, strength was definitely a factor. That's why I figured when he came to me in strength versus strength, that's where the amateur wrestling skills would come in hand, and I could convert some of his energy and use it against him.
Today at Cal International Wrestling Sunday Showdown, Dan Severin will compete in a special strong style exhibition match against Doug the Role Model Williams. Here's what Dan thinks he has to look forward to in today's matchup.
I never want to forecast what the outcome will actually be. I face each and every opponent the same way. I'll go in there, gear it up, ready to go, and take whatever openings they present themselves.
Dan Severin. Wrestling's Ultimate Fighter.
Fans, a very special, interesting match, a strong style match between Dan Severin from the Ultimate Fighting Championship, went all the way to the finals against, I don't know, this is a very awkward start. Wrestling fans, Dan Farron's going to have an interesting job with this match. Dan Severin, back at Cal International Wrestling, direct from the Ultimate Fighting Championship.
Starting out right away with a powerbomb-like maneuver.
And Doug, the Role Model, Williams. This should be an interesting exhibition, though, Ron. You did a great job ring announcing that.
And that's it. I can barely make my way back here, and I've got to get back to the microphone and announce the winner.
I don't know, wrestling fans, is that it? Could Dan Severin have won that fast? That
wasn't even a minute long, and
And the time of the match, 32 seconds. Here is your winner, Jan Severin.
That's amazing, wrestling fans. 32 seconds has to be a Cal International record as Dan Severin makes short work of Doug the Role Model Williams. And there goes Dan Severin back with Phyllis Lee. Boy, that was nothing like the Ultimate Fighting Championship, making unbelievable quick work of his opponent today.
The Role Model.
And Ron, I don't believe that.
Some quick, fast victories there. Dan Severin doesn't get paid by the hour. On how to order a videotape of the most talked about California independent wrestling card of 1994 is coming up very shortly. Southern California Wrestling. Shaking hands now with Dan Severin. Looks like we have a little announcement here.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. It's an honor to be here for this Cal International Sunday Showdown. It's a real honor. I thank a lot of you for remembering who I even am. A lot of times I don't even remember. Thank you. Okay, this is a big event. It's very important to them. Let's get into it right away. Can we have the bell? This match is for the Cal International Americas Heavyweight Championship and it's one fall with a 1 hour time limit.
Here.
Sunday Showdown. Jeff Walton hasn't lost a thing, Danny.
Well, same Jeff Walton I remember growing up watching wrestling from the Olympic Auditorium in the 70s. And right now, we're just waiting. America's Heavyweight Championship, waiting for the entrance of Al Snow. Here he comes, Al Snow. A big ovation from the wrestling fans here in West Hollywood.
And ladies and gentlemen, he's on his way to becoming a legend in wrestling. From Body Slammers Gym in Lima, Ohio, weighing in at 231 pounds, let's hear it for Al Snow! This is again for the Cal International America's Heavyweight Wrestling Championship, one fall with a 1 hour time limit.
Let's take our collective hats off to Jeff Walton. And there's the bell. Senior Cal International Wrestling referee, Dan Farron. Let's see if we could get Jeff Walton to join us here for a little bit of commentary.
That would be fantastic. Jeff Walton introducing the combatants and Cal International again, the word international, saying it all.
And Al Snow, Nishimura.
Nishimura, one of the top contenders for the America's Heavyweight Championship. And Snow, as you remember, battled Sabu to one of the most amazing matches ever in Aftershock 94. But Nishimura is an up-and-comer from New Japan and has been wrestling all the best wrestlers from around the world. So this should be an amazing match. And bring in right now one of my idols, I can say, someone I grew up watching.
Southern California legend, Jeff Walton.
What a nice compliment, gentlemen. Thank you very much.
Mr. Walton, I've not been formally introduced to you. Long head.
What a pleasure.
As we are watching two of the new young lions, the real new generation of professional wrestling. You're looking at them right now. Keep your eye on them, as they're gonna show us a true wrestling clinic. Here at Sunday Showdown, Jeff Walton in attendance. What do you have to make so far of this tremendous show?
First of all, you know, I can't. It's incredible the amount of talent that these young wrestlers have, and I'm very impressed. A lot of potential champions, even for ECW, don't you think?
I tell you, for ECW, for anywhere in the world, it's not also coincidence that but a few weeks ago, these two very combatants, without the America's belt on the line, battled to a classic encounter. In Philadelphia, these two sizing each other up, they know what each other's capable of.
Let's remember, tremendous endurance with these two guys, a 1 hour time limit. And I'll tell you something, I think both these guys can go an hour easy.
Oh, without question, Jeff Walton, these athletes of today, true students. These are athletes who have watched all through the days, going back to the golden age, through today, all around the world, and we have them right here. And again, in a feeling out process. These two don't want to get hasty with one another and do something they might regret. Dan Farron right on top of things to make sure that things are in order, and it certainly looks like it.
Well, he is the senior referee of Cal International Wrestling, and he's going to have to do a good job in a match like this with a championship title on the line, Ron.
Jeff Walton, a question for you. How much have you noticed a difference between strategies when two athletes can get in the ring and just say to go at it versus a time like this when the prestigious Cal International America's title is on the line?
You know, this is a championship match, and everybody wants to be a champion. We're talking about a lot of matches they've had to go through. They've had to come up in the ranks, and that's where they are now at this very minute. It's money, it's prestige, it's honor, and of course the belt with it. That doesn't hurt.
Certainly not, as well as the income that comes with the belt. As Al Snow with a great waistlift takedown. A series of chain wrestling maneuvers, both of these men reversing
and the fans watching intensely, and I tell you, they are indeed appreciating this, without question.
I think the fans have to appreciate, from what we've seen today already, the chairs being busted, the wrestlers being busted up, and this arena already becoming quite disassembled. It's nice to see two grapplers in the ring with some actual wrestling prowess ability, and a lot of interesting holds we haven't seen yet in Cal International Wrestling between these two. And again, Cal, the word international is saying it all about this wrestling federation. With wrestlers from Japan, from Mexico, from San Diego, all over the world, all here on Super Sunday.
The Sunday Showdown.
The Sunday Showdown right here in West Hollywood, California. And Jeff Wong,
well, there's
so great
no doubt about it that this is a big event, and it's going to continue to get bigger as the weeks and months ahead come about.
What a feather in the cap it would be for Osamu Nishimura to come in on Sunday Showdown as they start crisscrossing. Leapfrog by Al Snow. Hard clothesline.
And the fans showing a lot of response to that. A lot of Al Snow fans here after they saw the Aftershock 94 match between Snow and Road Warrior Hawk. You gotta have a lot of respect for this guy.
I tell you.
Oh, actually, Sabu, he wrestled. I was thinking Severn wrestled Hawk. And
wait, we have a cover, or rather a bridge and a two count.
And my thing is, Snow went to that amazing match with Sabu. He actually tore La Puente, California to pieces like another earthquake.
Oh, great German suplex. But Nishimura, two count.
And do you think Snow appreciates wrestling someone a little different than Sabu? This seems like a much calmer match for him. Maybe not as many chairs will be busted over his head like last time.
Well, this, for one thing, is different because we have a championship belt on the line. You tell me a crowd does not appreciate a true, pure wrestling match, Jeff Walton.
You know, the America's Championship, which is a sport, goes back a long ways. We're talking about such wrestlers and Freddie Blassie and John Tolis, even Bruno Sammartino at one time held the America's Heavyweight Championship belt. It's quite a prestigious belt, and I'm glad that Cal International is carrying on the tradition of fine wrestling.
We're trying to keep the bloodlines alive. Al Snow coming in with a hard backbreaker.
I'm sure it would be quite a party tonight on the way back to Japan for Nishimura if he can bring that title back home with him.
And a cover, a two. Two count only.
Referee Dan Farron just signaling two. Snow, I think, thought he had the match won. Oh! Kind of sliding home to first, and again.
Like he's trying to land into the tricep muscle area of Osamu Nishimura. The strategies these men are applying on one another.
Look at Jimmy Suzuki ringside, one of the greatest photographers in professional wrestling. At any big card, you'll see Jimmy Suzuki ringside. Look at him, getting right in on the action.
Right in, along with, we have dental care personalities, attorneys. They're all here. All the professions are coming out. Everyone.
I see a few roller derby stars. I see great, famous attorneys for cases I don't want to mention right now, but they're taking
one,
the show.
Two. Two count only, the champion. Al Snow, very tentative, not going in for the kill quite yet, going in with a rear chin lock, a wear down maneuver on Osamu Nishimura.
More than anything, you've got a lot of fans from Japan that have come in for this event, and that says something, doesn't it?
Absolutely. They support their wrestlers 100%. Nishimura, a huge crowd favorite in Japan. New Japan wrestling.
And look at this, going back to the basics now. Step over toe hold, reversals.
And that's why I'm saying, don't you think Snow appreciates this? When you come from a match against Sabu and Aftershock 94, I think he appreciates this kind of match much better. It's more to his style than a lot of table breaking and chair breaking. But
well, he's ready to do it all. That just goes to show you the tremendous versatility of Lima, Ohio's own Al Snow.
And that's what Cal International looks for, versatile wrestlers. And Al Snow is definitely one of them. Personal wrestlers come through the doors of the Olympic Auditorium, from John Tolis to Roddy Piper, Chavo Guerrero, Victor Rivera, some of the greatest wrestlers of all time. And we hope wrestling in Southern California is back again permanently like it used to be.
There's no doubt about it. If you just take a look at what you're looking at right this very second, and you can see the golden age and golden days of wrestling coming back with these fine young athletes.
That's what I think the fans in the Los Angeles area, even up in Northern California, as Ron Head can tell you. They want wrestling. They want wrestling like Cal International, like it was in the old days of the Olympic Auditorium, one of the greatest wrestling buildings in the world. And you again being the voice, you and Judo Gene LaBelle are the greatest duo. Beat the champ every Saturday night. We loved it.
Keep your eye on Al Snow. Doing something
think.
Referee Dan Farron right in the face of Al Snow, seeing if he wants to give up. I don't think Snow would give up too easily, especially with the championship at stake.
Well, every wrestler, you must remember, is human. And it looks like Mia have injured, looks like the hamstring muscle there. And Nishimura capitalizing on the situation, getting a bit more aggressive here, Jeff Walton.
Well, I'll tell you something, the belt's on the line, and we know that, like we said before, money, money, money. And that's what these two are going for, that title belt.
And, well, again, capitalizing with a figure four leg lock. How many men have you seen put away with this?
Quite a few. We're talking about Buddy Rogers and Johnny Valentine and, of course, the Intelligent Sensational Destroyer, and most recently, Rick Flair and the Nature Boy. So that hold is devastating.
And it looks like Al Snow is still holding tight. Dan Farron right on top.
10 minutes on, 50 minutes remain.
These two men pacing themselves for what looks like is starting out to be a real classic here. 1995 getting kicked off, Sunday Showdown. Well, we might not see this match continue much longer as we get a two count. I understand the pain of the figure four affects so many parts of your legs, your ankles, your knees. And if you're not paying attention, if you're thinking too much of the pain, those shoulders can come down, and there would be a new America's champion right there, Nishimura.
Trying to set it, going for that spinning toehold almost. It looks like he lost it.
The perspiration on these athletes.
Let's give referee Dan Farron some credit, doing an outstanding job so far and keeping some semblance.
Oh, the temper's starting to flare here.
It was only a matter of time, and these two wrestlers now going at it. Tooth and tooth, nail for nail. They're wrapped up, just punching away at each other.
But these are legal forearm blows.
And that will definitely take its toll. Look at the blows to the neck of Nishimura. And right now, Snow has the upper hand, backing Nishimura into the corner.
Al Snow breaking the momentum, sliding in.
This could be a main event anywhere in the world, anywhere, and you're watching it right this very moment on this program.
That's absolutely right, Ron, you know that.
And I tell you, that's something we've heard many times. However, watching this match, it is being proven to us that we're not just all talk. As a matter of fact, they're doing all the talking we need for us right now. True athletes. Wait a minute. Nishimura now with a standing version of a sunset flip and getting a two count.
Dan Farron having to slide from out of position and maybe a second too late to start that count. That might have been it. But only a two count by Dan Farron.
Well, unfortunate circumstances. Nishimura now with a backslide. One, two.
Ooh, half a second away, I'd call it.
From a new America's champion. And I tell you, double leg pickup. Comes over. One, two. Getting a two count. One, two. So close to getting a new champion here. Again, two. This time, Nishimura bridging all the way out.
Can't get him over.
What's he setting him up for? Trying to backdrop, getting a two count.
Well, I gotta say, I think Dan Farron's hand must be black and blue by now, and there's still about 45 minutes left in this match.
Oh, forget Dan's hand. How about these athletes here? No offense, Dan, but these two are beating.
Ooh!
What's happening here? Shoulders, are they down? Yes, one, two.
Amazing photographers from all around the world in attendance. As we saw Jimmy Suzuki, the man who you mentioned earlier, the man in the black at ringside, black and...
The dentist of the stars. Jeff Walton, have you ever received medical care from...
He's offered quite a bit. I don't know if I'd do it, though. I'm a little skeptical. I'm sorry.
I tell you, if he's as good with the...
Teeth.
Yeah, well, if he's good with the teeth as he is with the camera, as far as these two are...
Tell you, after this match, he may have to do some dental work on either Snow or Nishimura, because if this does go the time limit, 60 minutes, these guys may have a few teeth missing.
Mike Leno said that he would love to get in line to work on either of these two teeth, but he doesn't like waiting in lines. He wants to get right up there. Taking photos, both men going for drop kicks. I tell you, the evolution of wrestling, Jeff Walton. You've seen it all. You're keeping up. This is, in my opinion, more than just spectacular. This is an honor.
Are you talking about the evolution of wrestlers or wrestling photographers?
Oh. Low blow, cheap shot, and well, Al Snow all the way outside. On the hardwood, Nishimura being very cautious.
And the fans are being very good here, not touching the wrestlers. They're not supposed to. You come to a wrestling show, you're not supposed to touch the wrestlers in any way. And Nishimura getting up to four right now. Dan Farron with the four count.
We could see either of these two get the belt, and I tell you,
Nishimura is only 3 seconds away.
This would not be any disrespect to either of these two athletes.
Now, I don't understand that. Dan Farron got up to an eight count. Nishimura walked over to the ropes. Dan Farron has to start the count again.
Well, I tell you, in this championship match, Cal International rules, unlike what we witnessed earlier, titles can only change by a pinfall or submission. Look out, Nishimura! Out of nowhere.
And fans now better watch out. The first two rows here in West Hollywood are completely taken out. Photographers getting, I guess, the pictures they want right now. Nishimura seemed to take the fall pretty well. He's back in the ring in a matter of seconds, but Al Snow still lying on his back outside the ring on the hardwood floor. And I guess referee Dan Farron, maybe you're right. Nishimura doesn't want to win this match by a countout. He won't take the title home, so give him some credit.
The fans now gathering around. Not sure if this will be it. Could this be a countout? Very close. And, well, Nishimura again, breaking the count. It's one thing to have a victory, but it's another thing to take the belt. Al Snow now flipping over, super kick! The Snow super kick.
And this time it's Nishimura outside the ring. And Dan Farron starting his count, but Al Snow, no!
Look out, Al Snow! With his own plunge up.
Extremely high-risk maneuver by Al Snow, and he paid for it as both men are lying outside the ring. Dan Farron counting both wrestlers. Still a lot of time left in this match, Jeff and Ron, and I don't know, fans now better get out of the way.
Picking up Nishimura, slamming him.
Snow body slams Nishimura to the floor. Now Snow coming to the back. I don't know. Looks like he's
now going.
No, he's not grabbing a chair.
Getting the running start.
Tremendous clothesline on Nishimura outside the ring. Fans scattering all over the place. Jeff and Ron and Dan Farron trying to get the fans away from Nishimura, the fallen warrior on the ground right now. He's back up. And walking it off, boy, that would take me about an hour to walk off.
I don't know if I'd ever be able to. And I'm glad I'm there. I'm not there and here, rather. Al Snow, what is he setting him up for? A big power bomb. One, two, not a three. How much closer does it get to that? How much closer does it get to that three count? So many near falls.
What do you think so far, Jeff? Pretty unbelievable
match?
I'll
tell you something, Broadway Danny. The one thing that we have to think about is after the match.
Way to cover. One, two. So close.
Who is going to get the champion? Who is going to be able to sign whoever wins this match for future title defenses? That's the question, whether it's going to be ECW or Cal International.
Very good point. A lot of strategy amongst promoters trying to lure champions to wrestle on their shows. You're very accurate in that assumption, Jeff. And right now...
Oh, good Lord.
Al Snow, two.
Defeating one, two.
Ooh, and Al Snow almost with the pinfall.
We have another cameraman at ringside. He wants to be first in line in case we have lawsuits going on here.
Like I said, we have attorneys here. You mentioned a well-known dentist. Great Japanese photographers, roller derby stars, attorneys.
Even Peter Hines came all the way down, and he never travels.
Oh.
I'll explain later, Danny. Both of these men now almost on the point of sheer exhaustion. Fans here... Really, now a standing dropkick by Nishimura. That looked like it may have really dazed Al Snow this time. The champion could possibly be in some extremely serious trouble now. Gets whipped in the ropes.
Oh! What elevation on that dropkick! Nishimura. I can't believe how high up he got and went right to the jaw of Al Snow. And I don't know if Snow's going to be able to get up from that.
Very dangerous wrestling maneuvers here. We need to caution the fans at home. Little children, please do not attempt these moves. These are trained professionals. Do not attempt these maneuvers. That is, unless you want to look cool in front of your friends. Nishimura climbing all the way up to the top. God, dropkick. How many of those dropkicks can Al Snow take?
I don't know. It's been about four or five in a row, and you're right, kids.
Nishimura,
Ooh! Oh. That's about 2 7/8 right there, Jeff and Ron. And you were saying little kids definitely shouldn't try these moves at home, maybe unless they have a very soft couch.
There's a lot of big kids out there, too, that shouldn't try these moves.
That's those absolutely the ones right. I was talking to. Another drop kick.
You're right, Jeff. Big kids, little kids, don't try
this. One, two. Oh! No. These drop kicks are hitting Al Snow flush in the jaw. The champion is going to be in so much pain, and I tell you, Dr. Mike Leno must be watering at the mouth right now.
Oh, this can mean tremendous business.
Northern Light Suplex. One, two, three.
Oh! I don't believe
it. Beautiful Lido Bridge that he made.
Jeff Walt noting the Lido Bridge. You're exactly right, Jeff, and this match is unbelievable so far. Still about 40 minutes to go. I don't know if these two guys can last the entire 60-minute time limit.
Well, I would not be surprised either way. Al Snow looked like he's blocking what is a vertical suplex again, hooking him in. Not a suplex, just dropping him on the top rope.
3 minutes gone, 40 minutes remain.
What's he doing with him here? Very, very precarious position. Nishimura draped over that rope. Al Snow! Oh, lucky. Well, maybe not luck.
What? Some sort of guillotine using his leg to almost decapitate Nishimura. That might be it, guys. That could be it. Snow looking to put the finishing touches.
Hooking him in.
Come
with
on,
the bridge one. No, well, he's saying the shoulder's up. Now it's down. One, two, three!
Incredible. Just incredible.
Tremendous hard-fought encounter.
In 20 minutes and 43 seconds, the winner of the match,
Jeff Walton. A pleasure to have you here. Calling this match for the real new wrestling generation. Al Snow getting that title belt presented to him. Neither of these two men should be ashamed. As Al Snow finally getting his just desserts.
What do you want to do, Al?
I want you to quit asking me that stupid ass question.
January 15th. That's the day it's all gonna happen. January 15th, 1995. That's the day that J.R. Benson is gonna get to prove that he is the premier manager in the Golden State of California. And that's the day that J.R. Benson is going to get his ultimate revenge and settle his ultimate obsession. January 15th. And let me start with you, so-called legend, because this wouldn't be possible if it wasn't for you. Cal International came to me a couple months back and they said, JR, we've been watching you. We've been admiring you from a distance. We want you to come down here and rub some of your greatness off on Cal International. We want you to come down here and help us get this promotion off the ground. Make it what it can be. Return wrestling to Southern California. Now let me tell you something. There's nothing I hate worse than Southern California. Always have and always will. But I flew down to that cesspool because I want to do a favor to these guys. I come down there. They paid for my flight. They paid me a bunch of money. I come down there to do them a favor. I didn't even get to go to a big city. I wasn't in Hollywood. This wasn't Los Angeles, San Diego. No, La Puente, California, a border town, a beaner border town, if you get my meaning. Tamale stands. If we would have been any closer to the border, any southerner to that border, half of those people might have been legal citizens. You get the drift of what I'm talking about? But I came down there to La Puente set to make this promotion, to make the state of California so we don't have to carry it anymore up north. And they put me in the opening match. The opening match, and they put me in there, and then Johnny Legend. They give this guy top billing. Johnny Legend. Ow! Oh, wow! What the hell is this guy? They put him up on top? Let me tell you something, Johnny Legend. You're nothing but a big, overgrown freak cheerleader running around ringside with your big beard, your loud clothes, trying to make a spectacle of yourself, take some attention and put it on yourself, because that's all you are. That's all you are, is a big cheerleader. I am a strategist. I am a manager. I can get in the ring and do it myself, Johnny Legend. That's something you don't realize. You won't throw on the tights. You will never be half the man your mother was, and you will never get in the ring with J.R. Benson. I can get in there and do it myself, but that's not what I do. I'm a strategist. I'm the money man. I'm the brains behind the brawn. And when I come down there to conduct business and they put me first and give him top billing, that was more than I could stand, baby. J.R. Benson is the top manager in all of the country, all of the world. But Northern California is my turf. It's my stomping grounds. And I figured if they're going to go down there and treat him like he's got something over me, I might as well just move on and take the entire state for myself.
Challenge to you. I will bring down any wrestler in my stable from Northern California to face anyone of your choosing. The losing manager gets the hell out of this state, and then I'll rule the state. And I don't think you'll accept the challenge, because I've been all over the country. Everybody has heard of me. Who are you? You are about as relevant as a tampon in the purse of an 80-year-old woman, you freaking jerk.
The challenge was made. I told you to get anybody from your stable, and I get anybody from mine, and we'd settle it right there in Southern California, so I can embarrass you on your own turf, in front of your own people, and take the turf, and claim it for my own. So I went out. I could have gotten the Suicide Blonde Chris Candido. I could have got Michael Modest. I could have had Dixie Demon do it for me, because I'm flying him in too on January 15th. But no, I went and I got one of the hottest Lucha Libre wrestlers of all time. I got Ultraman, a huge star in Japan and a huge star in Mexico. And that's the reason I got him, because I want all those beaners to see that J.R. Benson can get one of the hottest stars from Mexico, bring him up north of the border, and with my strategy, my brilliance, we would prevail. So I told you, Legend, go out and do the best you can. I've seen your stable down here, and it's crap. I've seen it, and it's garbage. I told you, you better go out, and you better get a hell of a man if you want to defeat J.R. Benson. So what does Johnny Legend do? Johnny Legend goes out, and he gets one of the biggest stars in the world. He gets the most suicidal, the most genocidal, the most homicidal, death-defying athlete in the world. He gets the most dangerous man in wrestling. He gets Sabu. Huh, Johnny? Sabu, going into my past, trying to psych me out. Because everybody knows that 7 months ago, June the 19th, 1994, J.R. Benson, in the greatest triumph of his career, leading Chris Candido to the CCW Championship. And what does Sabu do when he knows that my brilliance paid off and put him down and made him lose and cost him that championship and cost him his reputation? What does Sabu do? He takes a metal folding chair, and he comes up to me, and he takes the ultimate cheap shot of all time and tries to bash my skull, tries to crush my skull, tries to commit murder. For all those people out there, that Father's Day bash videotape almost became a snuff movie, if you get the drift of what I'm talking about. long months, day in and day out, through all my triumphs, through all my tribulations, the one thing in the back of my craw, the one thing that's been eating me alive, the one thing that I cannot shake is that obsession with Sabu. That's obsession. When I looked him in the eyes and he did it, tried to commit murder, tried to bash my skull, the obsession of the 32 stitches that I took right upside the top of my head. And I have been saying, I have been telling everybody that the time I crossed paths with Sabu again, and I knew it would happen eventually, that I would get the ultimate revenge, and everybody's waiting for Sabu to end his own career. Everybody wants to know what's going to happen. I promise everybody I wouldn't let it go down that way, because I'm the one who's going to end the miserable, stinking, lousy, rotten career of Sabu. So Sabu, when you get up there this time, I'm behind a man who knows you well. He's wrestled you in Japan. He knows you. Ultraman. A man who can keep up with you. He can fly like you. He can do everything that you can do, Sabu. Only one thing. He's got me behind him. And I have seen more Sabu matches than anybody in the world. I have studied this man. I am obsessed with this man. And I want revenge. And Sabu, we're coming out there not just to win, but to hurt you. To end your career. To send you to the hospital so you can feel what I felt, only it's going to be worse, because you're going to have limbs broken, maybe a broken neck. We're going to do a career-ending injury, something you haven't managed to do to yourself yet, but we're going to be the ones to do it. And Legend, you thought that you would play the mind game with J.R. Benson. You thought you went out, you got Sabu, and that you were going to psych me out. Let me tell you something, that ain't the way it is. I've been waiting for the chance, but you know who's going to be psyched out? Sabu's gonna be psyched out, aren't you, Sabu? You people look back in 1994. Sabu's the hottest wrestler in the world. How many times did he lose in 1994? You got five fingers? Well, that's too many. You can't count too many times Sabu lost. But he went down in defeat on June the 19th, 1994, San Jose, California, Father's Day Bash, to Chris Candido, managed by J.R. Benson. And that's been eating Sabu up, too. He's psyched out. He knows I know the secret. He knows I know how to beat him. And Sabu, when you come down here to Hollywood this time, we're taking it to the bright lights. And when you got that idiot Johnny Legend in the corner, can't contribute nothing, Johnny, what can I do? Help me out. That's all you're going to get out of Johnny Legend. And I will lead Ultraman to the ultimate victory of my career. And Johnny Legend, I want you to come across that ring and admit that J.R. Benson was, is, and always will be the superior manager, the superior man. And Sabu, I've been waiting, and when you get taken out on a stretcher to the hospital, I am going to be the happiest man in the world, because I can say that I orchestrated the end of the career of Sabu. January 15th, 1995, get ready, Southern California. You're only going to get one glimpse of greatness before I take over and make you part of my kingdom. Johnny Legend, Sabu, Cal International, all you punks, you're going down.
Still available on home video, CCW's Father's Day Bash from the San Jose Civic Auditorium. Witness the classic ladder match between the most dangerous man on earth, Sabu, as he takes on the suicide blonde, Chris Candido. Hell broke loose in this match. Witness this classic. Own it on home video. All for $15 with priority postage included. And oh yes, the bonus hospital footage after J.R. Benson was destroyed with a steel folding chair. Send $15 cash, check, money order to the address on the screen and get ready. CCW's Father's Day Bash, along with six other incredible matches, you'll want to tell all your friends about it. Order it, and you won't be disappointed. But not least, effective November 6th, 1994, all orders placed for Father's Day Bash. That is anybody who sends in $15 for the Sabu versus Chris Candido in a ladder match will receive everything previously mentioned, including the match, including the hospital footage, including the music video, including the uncensored backstage interviews. You will also receive this, the previously unreleased Pinfalls Count Anywhere in the Building match in its entirety between, yes, Sabu and Cactus Jack. Everything mentioned for $15 with priority postage included. What are you waiting for? Of a cold reception for Ultraman. JR bringing Mistress Stacy to ringside along with Ultraman. Not at all a warm reception. Music fans, this will be scarier than Halloween, as this man is for real Michael Myers' worst nightmare. The music, the anticipation. J.R. Benson.
Sabu is gonna go down to Ultraman.
The vengeance. What will we see today? Johnny Legend has bring the man from JR's past, and there he is!
And Wrestling Fans of all day, accompanied by Johnny Legend!
Sabu does not want an introduction at all! He is the man who needs no introduction! Zealous fans here. And just from the manager's challenge, chasing each other away, and Ultraman starting out with chops and a whip on Sabu. This match already starting out at 100 miles an hour. And Sabu, starting out, wasting no time, but catching himself, climbing all the way to the top and flipping, the top and flipping, all the way down onto the... And it looks like Sabu caught his ankle.
Sit down. Everybody sit down.
What? Fans already getting behind their new cult hero, the man who beat out the Nature Boy for the first time ever as the most favorite wrestler from readers across the country and across the world. And there is the man who is ready to put his body on the line regardless. The man who will give himself pain, and already starting out, bringing a chair in the ring, shooting Ultraman in. Wait, Ultraman catching the chair now. Into the corner now, Ultraman springing off the chair. Oh, it's Sabu this time catching him. But his ankle covering him, one, two. only getting a two count here. His ankle in tremendous pain. I would guarantee you that many multiple parts of Sabu's body must be in agony right now as he, on a nightly basis, puts his body on the line like no others. However, Ultraman trying to get back to the basics. Rearing back on the leg, going to work on what he's seen a weak spot. The Achilles tendon. Sabu, many have argued that he does not feel pain. Not true. The man does feel pain. However, many question whether or not he actually enjoys pain. For some people, they would claim that Sabu thinks this is a fix. This is a fix for himself. I wonder what's going on in the back with Legend and J.R. Benson, as this was the manager's challenge, whipping Ultraman in. Ultraman quickly climbing. And it looked like from this vantage that, yes, Sabu's ankle has given out on him again. This could maybe be a huge advantage for Ultraman. Fans should stand back as Sabu, so dangerous anywhere. Ultraman kicking Sabu out. Look out. Stand back, fans. Dive. Dive outside in Sabu's ankle. Get out of the wrestler's way, fans. It's for your own safety. Sabu is a very dangerous man without pain flowing through his body. And right now he could be like a wounded bear. So dangerous, able to strike at any time. Able to make his way. Well, his ankle barely able to support himself now as he climbs back in the ring. Ultraman now has a blow blocked. But Sabu's ankle giving out from underneath him.
Look out,
fans!
Move!
Oh! Ultraman tried to whip Sabu, which could have been curtains for him. With that ankle, it could have given out completely. Ultraman now looks like he's in his own kind of serious trouble as all the chairs take it. Directly at the top of the head. Sabu asking the fans, move out of the way. Better do it. Fans are everywhere scattering for their safety. Now Ultraman going back out. Sabu favoring his ankle. I've never seen him in such trouble here. Ultraman now very quick. Taking the chair, and that's anything goes match, but misses a splash with the chair underneath. Ultraman obviously studying tapes. He's setting him up for the Arabian face buster, but misses. That would have been it. Again, missing with the Arabian face buster. Leg drop with a chair underneath. That time, connecting. There's no question who the fans are behind here in this match. Sabu throwing the chair out. And a cover, one, two. Ultraman kicking out. And this is without the advantage of having J.R. Benson and Mr. Stacy in the corner. Now Sabu maintaining the front chancery. Trying to wear down. Tell me there's no strategy in his body. Not true. There's a brain behind this man. Look out. Sabu flipping over with the leg drop. But it looks like it may have hurt Sabu worse, although he gets a cover. One, two, not a three count.
Take him out here and finish him off.
Ultraman now. That right arm. I think Sabu's trying to buy some time now. As it's obvious to everyone here that ankle, something happened within the course of this match. And that ankle has to be hurting. It has to be throbbing. Now Ultraman walking the ropes, very agile, very cat-like. And flipping him over. Ultraman staying one step ahead.
Roger.
It's over.
And Sabu.
Step back. Everybody step back. Guys,
guys, guys. Watch out, fans.
We got my chair.
That chair going right into the throat. Sabu is in some grave danger now. Nobody in his corner to protect him from this. And this anything goes match, Ultraman.
Hey, there's a film canister down there. Use that one.
Pulling whatever he can out of his arsenal. If it includes using a chair, so be it. Sabu now favoring his neck, still his ankle. Sabu is the type of man who likes to proceed with the pain. I tell you, it's questionable whether or not he enjoys the pain. But I can tell you, he certainly is getting his fix of pain. Sabu retaliating now with the boot. And a flying bulldog-like maneuver. Downing Ultraman. A mysterious ult. Oh! Sabu using a guillotine-like maneuver, which I really can't describe. Hard to describe a maneuver you've never seen in your life. And Sabu's leg, every time, it's taking a little bit more out of the leg. Covering him. One, two. Only a two count. Sabu. Quick cat-like. That just drops down.
Fuck.
Certain expletives being shouted out now. A cover, lateral press, one, two. Ultraman still able to kick out. Unbelievable the amount of punishment these two are dishing out against one another. Hooking him in, belly to back suplex. Nope, draping him over the top. But Sabu fighting his way, he does not. And sunset flip into a powerbomb. That ankle keeps giving out. Covering him, one, two. Referee John Hanna counting a two, a standing Frankensteiner. One, two, only a two again. Ultraman is so close to being the loser in this match. However, you gotta think Sabu now with that ankle. Look, favoring the ankle again. And a right. Catching Ultraman all the way in the top. Frankensteiner, however, Ultraman held on. Sabu in, oh, drop kick. Sabu, as the fans race around, they want to see this firsthand. A flip onto Sabu. Sabu's eyes glazing over. The eyes rolling back into his head, as is Ultraman, I'm sure. Normal men, dare I say mere mortals, are not meant to do this sort of unbelievable, grotesque-like treatment to one another. You hear about people talking about the new generation. This is it! The man with no regard, basically hobbling him, launching down onto Ultraman. Fans, there's no need to toot your horn for how incredible this match is. Fans, standing table. That's not a table for Sabu.
Sabu, give us a
seen bridge game tables with a higher endurance than that, and Sabu wants none of it. We've seen what he's done before. Pulling all the shirts aside, and Sabu with the real table. Folding the leg down. Stay back, fans. Sabu does not need to speak. Sabu has everything speak for himself, bringing the table. Many say his number one ally. At the same time,
That table is Sabu's number one enemy. Whipping him in reverse, Sabu head first into the table. And down, sending the full weight of the table down onto Sabu. Who's got to be aching from every pore in his body. Ultraman with what looks like to be one last ditch resort. Draping Sabu on the table without the legs. Very little give here. Trying the moonsault. And it looks like his head connected onto that table. You see, tables don't give. Pointing skyward, dropping a DDT onto the table. And this is patented, trademark, Sabu. Ultraman DDT, Sabu still limping. But one thing that he has, I dare say lacking in many of today's professionals, Sabu, deranged or not, asking for a chair. Crazy, suicidal, homicidal, genocidal, death-defying. He is the man with more heart than any man. A chair for the top turnbuckle. Leg drop. Covering 1, 2, 3. So Johnny Legend man with another victory. Benson and Johnny Legend nowhere to be found now. And where's Sabu hobbling off to? Where is he going? All the way to the back. In a lot of pain, hobbling away. Sabu, your winner in our main event at Cal International Wrestling's Sunday Showdown. There's the damage. Ultraman doesn't look like he's moving. Referees John Hanna and Dan Farron consoling Ultraman. And let's see if we can get a better look at this. Ultraman may be seriously injured here. The table, what's left of it? One of Sabu's calling cards. And there's a direct result of what happens when you cross the path of the most dangerous man. Not only most dangerous wrestler, most dangerous man, most dangerous human. Sabu. Ultraman looks like he will need serious medical treatment here as he's signaling something with the neck. Be very careful with him. Fighting through. Ultraman with without a doubt a valiant effort. Fans still gathered around to see what the condition is. Incredible matchup, fans. Again, let me bring to your attention, while other fans are watching other promotions deliver what they call a product called New Generation Wrestling. This is what it's really all about. No need to toot our own horn for this. But fans, is this where wrestling's going? Is this what the sport of professional wrestling is leading to? I hate to ask the man laying in the ring there, but he is not moving. Apparently, they're calling upon paramedics. An ambulance is being summoned.
We need another table.
And well,
Senior referee, Dan Farron, being very ingenuity, using a lot of ingenuity. Dan Farron not taking too kindly to the comments, as Ultraman is seriously injured. Being very wise, a very smart idea. As apparently it's best to keep Ultraman in a flattened position, not wanting to injure him any further, and moving, manipulating him. Fans now, I don't know what to make of everyone. They seem to be, well, shocked, in awe of what they have witnessed. How often does a Sunday Showdown from Cal International blow into your town? And here comes our makeshift stretcher.
Hold in the legs.
Here comes what hopefully will be transportation for Ultraman. And it's some medical care. The table being brought in. Ultraman being instructed just to lay still. As they're trying to take care of him. Using tremendous caution here. Oh. Moving Ultraman over onto the table. I mentioned earlier in jest for people not to try what you see here at home. Now it's very serious. And yes, a nice round of applause for the men you see right there. I hate to say there's no losers in a match like this.
Here's one part man.
This could be exactly what happens, fans.
Hey, you might have to take him this way. Oh.
Using extreme caution.
Wrestling fans, we thank you for attending. Drive safely. We hope to see you right back here in the same room on March the 19th. Hope on your way out.
Shut the door. Shut the door. Shut the door. Give us some room.
Fans, I understand that there is some sort of altercation happening on another side of the building in the corridors between J.R. Benson and Johnny Legend along with their wrestlers. Details are very sketchy. Let's see if we have, yes, we do have a remote camera on site. Let's get over there now. Wait a minute. Wait, we lost reception there, fans. Something happened. They tripped over the cable. Wait, we're getting it back. We're getting it back.
We're okay.
Right. Let me tell you, Legend, I'm sick and tired of you sticking your nose in my business. You just ruined the greatest opportunity in my life to get revenge on Sabu. And now you come out here, take a cheap shot in the back of my head. Let's end it next time. You come here with your team, the Mechanics. I'll come here with my team of Southern Comfort. You put up that beard. I'll put up my hair. And the loser will get shaved. What do you think of that, punk?
What? Damn it, we keep losing reception. This time, Johnny Legend not even being able to answer the challenge from JR. What's happening? Get another remote camera out there. Come on, get it!
Heard enough!
That's what I want to know. Will you accept the challenge? My hair versus your beard.
All right, looking. Listen here, gums are bleeding, hairline's receding, okay? You haven't got enough left on that bald palate of yours to even put up for a match. This counterfeit Confederate, these other idiots.
Let me tell you something,
I didn't even have to stand in the ring there today to see you
go down
and defeat again. The last time Sabu gave you 20 stitches, tonight your man is on the way to the hospital, and I'm sick and tired of you bad-mouthing Southern California because it does a bad enough job on its own. I'm telling you something, brother, we got helicopters crashing on our freeways, we've got the Menendez brothers and OJ here, and what have you got, like I said once before, Diane, Frank, and Feinstein? You got the Mitchell brothers sitting around getting stoned and killing each other. Okay, now what? You haven't got anything to put up.
Man.
I'll put up my beard, I'll put up my hair, I'll put up my armpit hair, and I won't go any further without an x-ray. But let me tell you something. What I want from you is not that billy goat's gruff you call whatever that pubic hair is all over your face. I want loser leaves Southern California forever. Out, gone, goodbye, kaput. I'm sick and tired of you coming down here. And I'll...
Let's go.
And I'll get in the ring with my men and finish it off. Yeah, see that? That's it. Show off that crown over your shine in there.
Why don't we just do this, huh? Okay. Why don't we not make it loser leaves Southern California, loser leaves Northern California, loser leaves the entire golden state of California? Because let me tell you something. Legends are always either old or dead, and you're looking about like both of them. So I will get there in the ring and take your man, and my man will beat yours, and you'll be out of the state. What do you accept?
One thing you got right is the part loser you're already fulfilling to the max. My men are called the Architects of Anarchy. You couldn't even get their name right. We are Anarchy Incorporated completely.
Anarchy.
You got a counterfeit Confederate.
I get your
Get this guy out of here. Jim Cornette would flush down the toilet. Let me tell you something.
Okay, that's it.
I will get up any hair on my body for you to leave Southern California.
Let's sign.
Okay, that's it.
March 19th, the California Classic. Johnny Legend puts up his hair and his beard.
And anything else he can find, but I'll tell you, when he starts looking, he sure doesn't find much.
That's fine and dandy. J.R. Benson, if your team loses, you must leave the state of California.
Listen up.
I'm not going to make this a tag team match. You will team with your two boys. It'll be a six-man match. If your team loses, you lose the hair, you lose the beard. If your team loses, you're out of California.
No problem. I'll fly down to the cesspool, and I'll defeat Johnny Legend.
One last thing I want to point out. How about that tiny little pearl that his so-called old lady has on her tongue, for those of you who saw
it? Okay.
Thank you.